The two committees embarked on an inquiry into the operations of the contract between the government and the Russian firm, joint stock company Global Security, to install digital trackers in two motor vehicles following a petition by the Toro District Woman MP Sarah Opendi. In its findings, Parliament has established that government did not carry out due diligence on the contractor, as no due diligence report was available to the probe committees.
Having ascertained the restricted security nature of the transaction of the ITMS, the ministry ought to have first developed the solicitation documents, clearly spelling out what they wanted. Then the contractor would develop interest, if any, in taking up the project with clear expectation.
Of dissent is on the failure to conduct a due diligence on the company, and the minority report thinks that the due diligence was not properly done on this company in accordance with section 26, subsection 2C of the PPP Act.
The committees noted that they did not find time to benchmark and carry out due diligence of their own on this project aimed at enhancing crime management through detection, identification and recognition of all vehicles and motorcycles operating in the country, though the majority committee report endorsed the deal.
The president guided that we should deal with this matter after criminality had taken place, mainly using getaway transport.
The committee established that the traffic violation fines are one of the fundamental avenues for raising revenue for the contractor to recoup the initial capital investment. Approximately $974 million revenue is expected to be generated from speeding violations, traffic fines and penalties, sale of digital registration plates, among others.
We observe that these are not in line with the Road Safety Act of 1998, Traffic and Road Safety Act of 1998, and therefore there is a need for harmonization of these fines with the existing laws.
The committee observed that the money collected from fines should form part of the consolidated fund under non-tax revenue, and Parliament must appropriate these funds. However, the matter attracted mixed reactions from legislators, as many expressed concerns that this project encroaches on people's rights to privacy.
Who did this quantification to arrive on the investment? Later on, for us as Parliament to trust that the amount mentioned in the investment is the actual amount that we should let Ugandans pay at the end of the day at the recovery point.
Every time President Museveni has directed something to be done, there are people who are doing things behind the rights of the people. And at the end of the day, there is no clear guidelines, there is no clear procedure of how implementation is taking place. That is where the problem is.
Others queried the government for contracting a company which is battling with issues of liquidity and warned that it may be unable to implement the 10-year deal.
Just because we want kickbacks, because I'm not sure why someone can go in and accept a company that is bankrupt. So is Uganda becoming a trading ground?
We could only identify this company which was heavily indebted, which have some dirty history, and then we try to clean it here. Can't we look for another one which is good, which has a good record?
However, the Attorney General Chiriowa Chiwanuka made a clarification before Parliament that the agreement was thoroughly studied and cleared, with no negative legal implications.
We can assure you that we'll do our best as the executive to ensure that this is done in accordance with the Access to Information Act, as has been laid out in this Parliament. But the risks are existent, and that is why we write the laws. And if anyone breaches those laws, we shall deal with that person in accordance with the laws.
Report compiled by Fred Kajubi for the News at Parliament.